You are watching a video lesson in the lecture series of Botanypedia to help you learn about various concepts of biology. And this e-lesson is a part of a biostatistics lecture series. I am Dr. Pawan Kumar, and in this lesson we are going to learn about various types of data that we use in biostatistics, or we can say the types of data in statistics. So this lesson contains definition of statistical data. What are the sources of data? What are the various scales of measurement of data? Two methods of data collection, and in the last we will compare reliable versus valid data. So what is the definition of a statistical data? So in statistics or biostatistics, when we are dealing with any kind of record, it can be a descriptive record or a qualitative account or even a symbolic representation of any attribute, event, or any process that can be expressed in any number form or in any quantitative form. This is known as data. So any record, descriptive or qualitative account or symbolic representation of any attribute, event, or process that is expressed in a quantitative form is considered as a data. This is an example to explain you what is statistical data. For example, in a survey you recorded the IQ levels of students and it was given a particular value after the assessment. So five students were interviewed, and based upon that their IQ levels were recorded. So if you see the here, we have recorded the names of the student in the second column and their respective IQ levels in the third column. So here the data is being described in terms of numbers. So we can say that this is a quantitative way of recording a particular data. So the IQ levels of students depicted here by a particular number represents data. So another example could be the heart rate of any diabetic patient or many diabetic patient, and different types of comparisons can be made with that kind of a data. So anything that you are recording, sometime when we are recording the data, it may not be in the number form, and because sometimes, like for example, when you are taking interviews or when you are asking questions in surveys, like mostly where the answers are either in terms of yes or no, then that kind of a data is actually also known as descriptive or is known as qualitative data. So we will discuss about that in a subsequent slide in detail. So let's have a look at some other aspects of statistical data. So in simple terms, we can say that the data represents a set of values that are measured in some ways. So these numbers are the scientific records of experiments performed that are based upon the observation. Mostly they are the outcomes of experiments. So what are the various types of data sources? What is, from where we get the data, or how we generate the data, or how we reach to a point where some parameter is measured or expressed in terms of numbers? So there are basically three ways by which we can get data. One of the very important and primary way or the data source is from the experiments. So these experiments can be performed in fields, and these can be performed in labs or in hospitals. The data obtained from these places is analyzed and conclusions are published in scientific journals. So one of the primary sources of data is from the experiments. Then we have surveys. So these surveys are conducted to obtain important data on prevalence and incidence of a disease, or to obtain the pre-existing trend. So there may be some kind of a trend related to a question that you are asking. So in order to formulate or to describe the patterns of that particular question, you need to conduct a particular survey. So surveys are the some other ways by which we can collect the data set. Then we have records. There are pre-existing records that are recorded in registered or we can say in databases, and from those sources we can retrieve the data and can perform statistical analysis. One of the various very famous database in the medical sciences is that of the NCBI, where we have all the sequence data of RNA sequences, DNA sequences, and even amino acid sequences. So the data can be obtained, retrieved from there, and we can proceed with further analysis. So there are pre-existing records that can also act as data sources. These days, there is one term which is very popular or famous, that is meta-analysis, where the people retrieve data from already published journals and they work on a particular question or a hypothesis, and they analyze the data and make their conclusions. So that kind of a data is known as secondary data. So now we will look at the various levels of data measurements, and this topic is also known as scales of data. So what is data? As I have already described in my previous slide, there are two types of data: qualitative data. So what is qualitative data? It is also known as categorical data or discontinuous data. The another type of data category is quantitative data, and it is also known as continuous data or numerical data. So what is qualitative data? So when we are doing some kind of a survey, and there the answers that we are getting can only be categorized into distinct categories, then that kind of a data is referred to as qualitative data. So furthermore, the qualitative data can be further categorized as nominal data or the ordinal data. So what is nominal data? So nominal data is, nominal term is used for those data set where the categories can be named, but there no order can be determined. For example, if you are categorizing a data set on the basis of gender, so there you are dealing with either it can be the respondent of a survey can either be a male or a female. So you can put male and females in any order. So there is no order, but there are names of the categories. So that kind of a data is nominal data. So what is ordinal data? So as the name suggests, ordinal, order. So along with the names of the categories, there is some kind of an order. Like for example, if you are dealing with the severity of a disease, and there are three categories, like you can say the mild cases, moderate cases, and severe cases. So you are having some kind of order when you are categorizing, you're making categories. So that kind of data is known as ordinal data. Another example can be of an education level, where you see the students can be categorized as a high school students or a senior secondary school students or the college students. So there is some kind of order that is there. So in quantitative data, where most of the data are in numbers, so that's why they are called quantitative. So when you are taking any measurement of any parameter, and in that parameter you are measuring it and you're getting it some number form, in the number form you call it quantitative data. So the quantitative data can be of further two types. It can be either interval type or it can be a ratio type of data. So what is interval data? So in this kind of data, what it is, all the attributes, all the way we define the ordinal data is the same as we define the interval data, except that we have the data in the form of equal intervals. So suppose you measured some quantitative attribute of a parameter and you got some numbers, and since the data set was very huge, so what you did, you made some groups. So you did some kind of a grouping so that the data can be presented in a simple form. So here there is some kind of an order, but the organization of data is such that they are organized in terms of equal intervals. In the ratio, it is same as the interval, meaning that they are same as ordinal data, they have equal intervals, But here the zero has a meaningful essence. So in the what is the difference between the interval and the ratio data? That here the zero is very well defined in case of a ratio. So these are the some examples here. So you can see the gender is an example of nominal data, because it can be male, female, and there is no order. You can put you can organize data in any way. There is no hierarchy. In blood group also, as we know, that it can be A group, B group, AB group, and O group. So there are four categories, four names of the category. That's why it's a nominal data, but there is, so we can put any of the blood group in any of the order. So it is an example or another example of nominal data. There are three examples which are mentioned here. So education level, as I already mentioned. The second example is grades in a class. So we know that the A grade is better than B grade. So we are naming the categories. That's why they are called name categories. And we are deciding which is, there is some kind of a order or some kind of a hierarchy, which is better, which is poor. So that is the second example of ordinal data. Similarly, you can have the severity of a disease, like in the stages of cancer, you can have different categories. In for the interval scale, there is an example of a temperature scale. So, and in the ratio scale, you have any data that like, for example, you have the weight of individuals or the height of individuals. So these two examples fall into the ratio kind of a data, and broadly we can say they are quantitative data. So now we look at the example of a qualitative data, which is also known as categorical data. And here is a data statement, is one data statement to explain this. A population of insect was collected from a field. So a researcher went to a field and he or she collected a group of insects, and insects were further categorized into different stages of instars. So usually there are 4 to 5 stages of growth of development in the larval stage. So depending upon the size and other parameters, we categorize the larval and duration into different stages. So we can call them simply as stage 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5, or we can also call them instar 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. So here, since we are categorizing the data set into four groups, which is first instar, second instar, third instar and fourth instar. So definitely, since there are categories and since they are discontinuous in nature, so this is an example of qualitative data. So please note that such a type of data is discontinuous in nature. So what is the meaning of discontinuous data? Here they have distinct categories. There is no range. So the ones that are from of the first instar, they are solely from the first instar. So now we will look at one example of a quantitative data. It is also known as continuous data. And here is another example to understand this. So continuing from the previous example, suppose you wanted to measure the total amount of protein content in the stomach juice, or you can say the gut juice for insect. And whatever values you measured for the total amount of protein in their gut juice, it was recorded for the insects that were fed on diet 1. And following values were obtained. So in this table you can see that how many insects were used. So if you total them all these insects, you will get to know how many insects were used in this experiment. But after performing the experiment, when you got the values of the total protein, you found that the value of the total protein varied from 0.5 to 3.5 mg per ml of the juice extract. So based upon, so in order to simplify how, in order to represent the data in a very simplified way, what was done, they were grouped in some small groups, like all the values, all the insects whose value for, were between 0.5 to 1.0, they were recorded in this class, in this group. Likewise, it was done for all the others. So here we can see that there is a grouping of data is being done, and the value of the total protein for all these insects varied anywhere between 0.5 to 3.5. So what we see here in this table, we see that the values of the total protein can be anywhere in the specified range. Such a type of data is continuous in nature. So this is a quantitative data. Why? Because we are having some parameter measured and expressed in numbers. So these are the this is an example of a quantitative data. So there are two methods of data collection, broadly speaking. So first method is called census method and second method is called sampling method. So in this first method, which is called census method, the data is mostly collected by inquiry. So it is inquiry based. In the sampling method, data is collected by selecting a pool of observations taken from a population. So how we get these observations? By doing some kind of experiments. So what are the advantages and disadvantages of using both methods? So in census method, one of the advantages is that we see that the it has a high accuracy. It is a true representative, meaning that here you are selecting, you are making some questionnaires, and based upon those questionnaires you decide what kind of data you are going to get. It is results are more reliable. It has minimum bias because your questions are predefined. So you are going to randomly select any person and ask those questions, all those similar questions from different people. What are the disadvantages? It's expensive and takes more time because you have to go one by one to people or to different group of people and ask them similar questions. So it takes more time and it requires large number of investigators. In the sampling method, what are the advantages? It is more economical and requires less inputs because we can choose only a small sample size and conduct the experiment only using those individuals which are a part of that particular sample size. So we don't have to take into account the entire population. But the results that we get, it may be more suited for the large population. It is more scientific, but there are still some disadvantages, like wrong sampling can lead to bias. Sometimes we end up choosing a group of individuals which may be outliers, meaning that the parameters that they show, they may vary greatly from the population, the actual population. So if the sample size is very small, and the second disadvantage, the results may be misleading. So what is now we will look at what is the difference between a reliable data and a valid data. These two terms are very much used in biostatistics. When we are doing experiments and getting data, so we want to check whether how reliable your data is and how valid your data is. So these two terms are very different. Now we will look at the difference between a reliable data and a valid data. So what is a reliable data? A data is reliable if the experiments used to collect the data are, when repeated using same procedure, give the same result. So if you are repeating the same experiment with another set of population or a sample and you are getting the same result, then it is reliable data. But what is a valid, on the other hand, what is a valid data? So data that is collected using appropriate procedures that does not include any biased selection of observations is known as valid data. So data collection should ensure that we must ensure that the data that we are collecting is coming via appropriate methods or appropriate procedures. Only in that case we say that the data obtained is valid. So if you want to read more about these topics, these are the list of three books which are very good for undergraduate students. The links of each of these are provided in the description below. I hope you enjoyed listening to this e-lecture. If you really like this e-lecture, you can like, subscribe and share the link of this e-lecture. For more information, you can visit www.botanypedia.com. To receive a copy of this presentation, subscribe to our mailing list available at our website www.botanypedia.com. Thank you for watching.